Well, welcome. Thank you for being here for our first session. We're going to see how this kind of goes and if we need to modify things for the future sessions. We'll take a look at that. But we are going to look at three specific hymns out of the ELW, and I'll give you some backstory on how they came to be. And then we'll sing through all three of them. So you will want access to an ELW if you've got one in front of you. That's great. Before we dive in with that part, though, I want to just get a little context to hymns and to the music of our worship service and how all this stuff comes to be, because it's not random. It's actually very intentional, the way that I choose hymns and anthems that reflect the text that is being presented that each week. So we've got our resource, which is the Sundays and Seasons, and it gives you the readings for those weeks, and then it has suggested hymns for the gathering hymn, for the hymn of the day, communion hymns, and for the sending. And so we choose hymns from those suggestions, and I try to offer a good balance of familiar tunes that everybody knows and loves, while also introducing some new ones that you may not know. We have our new resource, the All Creation Sings, which it actually, even in there, it has some old hymns or familiar hymn tunes with some different texts. We'll talk about that here in a minute. But Katrina and I were just having a little conversation about this. It's nice to have those familiar songs, those familiar tunes, because it, whatever you're going through, I'm stealing what she said. It feels like you're coming to a familiar place, home. If you travel around, you'll still hear these same hymns, whatever Lutheran church you go into, as long as they're using the ELW, you should hear some of the familiar music, and that can be a real comfort to people. So first, we're going to take a look at some of the different things that you may have seen in the ELW, but you may not have known what it meant. So if you want to grab your ELWs out. Mine is digital. I've got it on my iPad, but it has all the same information. Open up to, let's say, 251. And when you get to 251, it's an Advent hymn, My Soul Proclaims Your Greatness. This is, the text is based on the Magnificat, so that's where the words come from. If you look down at the bottom, it says that. It says the original text was in With One Voice, published in 1995, based on the Magnificat. The music is an English folk tune arranged by Riff Vaughan Williams, who lived from 1872 to 1958. And it tells you when the stuff was first published, too. So the text was published again in 1995 by Augsburg Fortress. And this particular arrangement was published by Oxford University Press. Over on the right, the bottom right of the page, you'll see two things that you may have seen before. You may have no idea what those are. The first thing that you'll see there, it says Kingsfold. Kingsfold is the title of the hymn tune. So the melody that this song is set to is a melody with an origin of its own. So that melody existed before this hymn was written. And the hymn writer placed this text over top of that melody. So that melody, I'm just going to play it really quickly. Just for a second. More difficult to play while not looking at the piano than I thought it was going to be. But that melody, like I said, is an old English folk tune. It's been, no one knows who wrote it. It's been around for generations. Music is in its purest form, just kind of passed down from generation to generation with an oral tradition long before music notation even existed. So before people were writing these songs down, they were just singing them to each other, and so whoever came up with this has been lost to time, and we just don't know. But that's the Kingsfold. That's what that means. That's the hymn tune. There are going to be numerous hymns out of your ELW and even in ACS that use that same hymn tune, but with a different text. What? There are four. Four in ACS. Is that what you're saying? Okay. We're about to go to the index of we'll get there in just a minute. The thing below that is the meter. Now, the meter, it's different from, like, the musicians have a term, meter, which means something completely different. For the purposes of our hymns, the meter is just the number of syllables in each phrase. Now, this one is not very descriptive. It says CMD, which stands for common meter double. Yeah, thank you. If you want to go look at all the different meters that we have, you can go to the back of your ELW to page 1199. It says metrical index of tunes. That tells you the meter of each song. So common meter double has the following number of syllables per phrase: 8, 6, 8, 6, 8, 6, 8, 6. So the first phrase has 8 syllables, the next phrase has 6, and so on. Other meters are listed there as well. Some of them just list a bunch of numbers. That's, again, how many numbers there are is how many phrases there are in that hymn tune. And the number itself represents how many syllables in that phrase. So if you look, I don't know, there's... Exactly. So that's what I was about to do. Yeah. 250, but y'all are, did you read my notes? You're both like one step ahead of me. Yes, the hymn on the opposite page, 250, Blessed Be the God of Israel, you can sing to the Kingsfold tune. So you can sing, Blessed be the God of Israel who comes to set us free. That's not the melody that's written on 250, but it works. It'll work for any other hymn that has that CMD meter at the bottom of the page, which is kind of fun for me. I like to mix things up. You'll also end up with texts that are used for multiple hymn tunes. So just like you can slap a hymn tune on a different set of text that has the same meter, you can also take a set of text that has a certain meter and set it to various hymn tunes. An example is I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say is set to Kingsfold, but it also has a setting in our ELW that is to third mode melody, which I had it bookmarked and I lost it. 332. Okay, so 332 is I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say, which has a setting set to Kingsfold, but it also has this setting, which is third mode melody, which was composed by Thomas Tallis back in the 1500s. And this one, it even says at the bottom, alternate tune Kingsfold. So it gives you an example of how these hymns can kind of be changed up, giving you something familiar but also something different. I did this a little while ago for Palm Sunday. We were trying to come up with a procession. The setting of Ride On, Ride On in Majesty that we have in ELW is not a hymn tune that is super familiar. Pastor Michael's like, nope. So what we did was we picked a different melody that fits with that meter, and we sang that one instead. And so it was a little, I just had to give everybody a heads up, like, don't look in your ELW for this one, just read the words. We printed the words in the bulletin, like, just read the words and sing the melody. Mott's going to play it on the organ, and you can't mess up. So we have done that here at Christus Victor in the past. Okay. Anything else to add or share about that stuff? There are also things, elements of these hymns. There's a form, usually. The form has to do with, like, what kind of repeated material there is. So for that Kingsfold melody, the first phrase, that's going to be A, because that's the first melody. The next one, it's almost the same. It changes right there at the end, just a little bit. So sometimes you can call that like an A prime, or some people just call it both A because it's close enough. The next melody. That's going to be a B because it's completely different. And then it goes back to back to the A. So that form of that one would be A or A, B followed A or A prime. There's also there's no time signature written in any of our hymns, which is a little interesting. If you're a musician, that's something that you like look for, and you and it's not in any of it. You can't find the time signature in this book. And we had a little conversation about that as well. A lot of these hymns originated long ago as plain song or plain chant, before the concept of metered singing as we know it today existed. So they were just, they took the text and composers would set that text to a melody. It was usually just one line, one melodic line. They didn't have harmony at first. Everyone just sang unison. And then the stresses of the word would dictate where the accents fell. So you ended up with a lot of uneven metered melodies because the text had stresses in different places rather than regular stresses every four beats. You know what I mean? So you won't find any time signatures. Don't look for them. There's also key, which is just the collection of notes that are used for a certain song. And I'm going to talk about that later. That's the only reason I'm bringing it up. Because generally speaking, all these songs have a key signature, but you could not look at them and be fine. It doesn't help you or hurt you. Usually for members of the choir, they can tell that if there are like sharps or flats or something in the middle of a song, that's going to be something that sounds a little bit different. It's going to be changed slightly, and that's usually enough. But we will talk about key for one of these hymns that we're going to look at. So the origins, the sources of these hymn tunes come from a couple different places. Some of these are originally composed for the purposes of the hymn in the book. There are a couple instances. Well, there's one we're going to look at today that a composer just wrote this song, and so they assigned it a hymn tune based on the title of that song. It didn't come from anywhere else before that. Sometimes they will take a melody that somebody else has already written and put hymn text to that. So a perfect example of that is Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the Ode to Joy melody. Beethoven wrote that melody. Someone came along and was like, that's a really good melody. I'm going to put a hymn tune to it, and they did. The third main source is folk music, which we talked about with Kingsfold. It's an English folk song. No one really knows who wrote it. People have been singing it for generations, and so someone just took that melody and put a hymn text to it. The hymn texts also have different sources, and we'll talk about those kind of for each hymn that we're going to look at. And a lot of times they are scriptural. Sometimes the text is original. So we'll take a look at that. The first hymn that we're going to look at, is there any questions or anything someone wants to add on before we move into our first kind of hymn study? Cool. If you would open up then to 838, Beautiful Savior. I'm going to talk a little bit about this one, and then we'll sing through it. This one was suggested, I don't remember who, by. So Beautiful Savior, number 838. Again, if you look at the bottom, you can see kind of the sources. The text comes from a songbook. That's what that word, it's German for like a songbook, from Münster, Germany. The date of the manuscript was 1677. The translation that we use is by Joseph A. Zeiss. That's not what the book said. The book, by the way, that we're using is right here. It's called The Hymnal Companion for the ELW. And so all of the ELW hymns are in here. It's got a little couple paragraphs of information on each hymn. And then some general information in here as well. So the time signature, even though it's not written, you could look at it two different ways. You could look at it as a 4-4 song, which is the most common time signature. Or you could look at it as being more in cut time, 2-2. If you're, it depends on what you're feeling as the beat. I kind of am partial to the 2-2 cut time. The meter for this one is 5-5-7-5-5-8. So as we sing through it, you'll notice those are the number of syllables per phrase. So first phrase is beautiful Savior. Second phrase, King of creation. Phrase 3, Son of God and Son of Man. 7. All right? You can keep going. I'm not going to go through all of it, but that's the idea. That's how that works. And so for if there's any other hymn that has that 5-5-7-5-5-8 meter, you could set it to this tune. Or if you wanted to write your own text to fit with this hymn tune, you would just need to follow that syllabic order. Okay. Let me consult my notes to make sure I don't miss anything. We're in E flat major. Like I said, that doesn't. Most people don't need to know that in order to sing this. You just kind of sing what the melody does, and then when you notice that there is like a natural there, you know that that note's going to be a little bit different. It basically that note is borrowed from another key or another set of notes, so it's going to sound a little. Like a little bit of a departure from the main melody. And then we're eventually going to return to the main melody once the accidentals are gone. It's a Cilician folk tune that was transcribed in 1839. It's a German. There was this German composer. His name was, let me find it. This is why I should just go in order. August Heinrich Hoffmann von Fallersleben. He went around the countryside listening to people sing these folk songs and just writing them down for use later in other things. So we don't have the original composer of this text. It's from a Jesuit manuscript, again, that they found. Is printed in the Roman Catholic Munster Gesangbuch, songbook. There is a translation, the earlier translation is from Richard Storrs Willis. Ferris Lord Jesus is how he translated that text, and it has 5 stanzas. The version we use in the ELW was translated by, what was it again? Zeist? Zeiss. Okay. So the tune, this is actually a little, I think this is interesting. Schönster Herr Jesu, it's German for beautiful Lord Jesus. The original tune from that manuscript is not the melody that we use today, which I think is a little interesting. The manuscript melody, I actually pulled up a YouTube video of what it sounds like. So, a little bit different. The tune that we use today came from, like I said, that German folk tune that was transcribed. And it bears some melodic similarities to other German folk tunes, Silent Night. They both involve harmonies that are done in thirds, or reiterations of the melody done a third from where it started. That's kind of the overview of Beautiful Savior. That's all I've got. Does anyone have anything, any questions or anything they want to add to that before we sing it? Okay, I think we'll sing through all four verses and, pay attention to the way that the text pairs with the melody. When composers write music, they try to make sure that stronger syllables or more important words fall on strong beats and get some emphasis and weight that way. So the text, again, came from that like German manuscript that was written a couple hundred years ago. We don't know who wrote that text, so we can't say if they wrote more texts that we're using. The folk tune, we can find out if it's used in, if it's been used in any other text by going to that index, specifically the index of hymn tunes. I didn't have that page bookmarked, so I need a minute. So, hymn tunes, alphabetical, The index begins on page 1195, way in the back of the book. If we go to the S's, Shunshu Yezu is, that's the only hymn in this book that uses that melody. So if there were more, there would be more numbers listed to it, but it just says 838 next to it. But that's how you can find out if there are any other songs that use that melody in our hymn book. Okay? Any other questions, comments? Are you volunteering? Okay. Pastor said, let's write a hymn for that melody. All right. The next one we're going to take a look at is 787 on Eagle's Wings. So I'll go ahead and open to that. Now, this one, if you look at the meter at the bottom of this one, it says irregular. And if you look at the hymn tune, it says on Eagle's Wings. That is a good indication that this song didn't have any previous existence as anything else. And if you look at where it says where the text and music comes from, they both say Michael Jonkis, who was born in 1957. He wrote the text for On Eagle's Wings, and he wrote the melody for On Eagle's Wings, specifically for it was first published in a collection of hymns called Glory and Praise in 1979. So it was written in 1978, published in 1979. And this one, the verses are intended to be sung by a leader. It actually says that. Our hymn says leader or all, but the composer himself would disagree with that. The composer said that it should be sung by a leader. There are a couple of reasons for it. If you look at the melody of the verses, number one, it begins on a leading tone, which is not—it's not an easy thing to do for, especially for congregational singing. That's a difficult pitch to kind of be able to grab out of the air. There are several large leaps. There's a lot of syncopation. It kind of migrates through different key areas. So, you can see the accidentals in the second line there. There's a flat followed by a natural a little bit later on. So it's kind of migrating through these different collections of notes, which can be difficult for a congregation to do. So it really is intended for that leader on the verses, and then everyone joins in on the refrain. And the rhythm also changes with each verse. You notice that a lot of times when you have hymns with multiple verses, they're all printed like one under the other and numbered, 1, 2, 3, 4. This one, it's got verse 1 written out, and then it's got the refrain. And then it's got another line for verse 2, because the notes are different, the rhythms are different, nothing matches up with what you sang back in line 1. And then you go back to the refrain, and then it prints verse 3 again. So this one is really intended for that kind of leader congregation format. The texts that he chose for this hymn come from a couple different sources, actually. And He Will Raise You Up on Eagle's Wings comes from Exodus 19:4. The second line, Psalm 139, comes from Psalm 139. The text is Bear You on the Breath of Dawn. The inspiration behind that was the line from Psalm 139, Take the Wings of the Morning. Make You to Shine Like the Sun seems to call to mind from Revelation, talking about the white robes. And then Hold You in the Palm of His Hand comes from Isaiah 49:16. So that all of the text kind of comes from a bunch of different sources. The verses mostly come, not mostly, the verses all come from Psalm 91. So if you pull up Psalm 91 and read it along, it's not exact. It's not like every single phrase from Psalm 91 makes it into this hymn, but you can very easily have them side by side and see, oh, this line came from this line in the psalm. So that is where this hymn comes to us from. Are there any questions, comments? Oh, okay. So, again, repeating what he said for our YouTube audience, I guess. This hymn also appears in With One Voice with a couple of differences. One of those differences being there are only three stanzas instead of four. We're also going to look at that in the next hymn we're going to talk about. There's a difference. What? Oh, yeah. Change in the perspective. It says, with one voice, it says, and he will, and I will. So we change it from I to he. So yeah, that's interesting. So the With One Voice was published when?
95, and
later. So we changed it to the ELW version. There you go. Anything else? Pastor, you had something? Yeah. Yeah, it's like it's a moving target because the verses are different. The rhythm is different every time. So yeah. So if there's unless there's something else, I think we'll go ahead and sing through this one. And as intended, we'll do a leader and then. No, I was going to do it unless someone else really wants to get up here and sing it. I kind of figured I'd be doing it, but this is which is. Do you want to do it? Okay, come on up here.
I don't know this one too well.
Do you want me to do the first one and you do the second or something like that? So you can hear. The melodies are generally the same. There's just slight differences in the rhythm. So.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to try four too as well? So we alternate. It's on the last page.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, one more thing to note is that there is a final refrain noted after verse 4. The only difference is that you just hold out hand longer because it's the end. So, yeah. So you'll sing the refrain that's printed on that first page after verses 1, 2, and 3. And then after verse 4, sing the final refrain when we get there. All right? Okay. Do you want to just do it out of... Okay.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in this shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust. and He will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun.
Coda added on the end where you repeat the last line. Yeah, and Mott was saying she's having to like look back and forth because the verses jump around in her book as well, so. How many have heard this hymn at a funeral? It's a pretty popular funeral pick. In the book, there's a conversation back and forth between the author of the book and the composer of the piece, and the author, I guess, presented some criticisms of this hymn. One of them was he's like, this is a really difficult congregational hymn because of all the reasons that we listed. And he's like, and that's where he said it was never intended to be sung that way. The other criticism, I guess, that he mentioned was the way that he put this text together leaves some room for interpretation. It's kind of a subjective. You can interpret it a couple different ways, rather than being kind of an objective text. And the composer was kind of like, well, that's okay. It should be, you know, viewed through the lens of whoever is reading it, whoever is singing it and performing it and hearing it. So, that's just kind of a philosophical discussion, I think, to be had. The name of the publication, the book that was published, was Glory and Praise. That's where it first appeared. Yeah. And the it's a popular hymn across denominations, and so good pick. Again, I don't remember who picked that one, but this last one that we're going to look at today, I picked it. It's number 710, Let Streams of Living Justice. So this, I picked it because I love the hymn tune, as I started reading about it, I was convinced that it was the one that I wanted to talk about. So, again, I'm going to try and stick to my notes, and actually have a couple spots where I'm going to be reading directly from the book, because I don't want to try and paraphrase some of this. So, it was written in 1989 by William Whitla. That's the year I was born. The hymn tune is Thaxted. We'll talk about that first, I think. Thaxted, as a hymn tune, was originally composed by a composer named Gustav Holst. He wrote a symphony called The Planets, and it's a seven-movement symphony. Pluto hadn't been discovered yet, but that's okay, because now it's not a planet anymore. And he also didn't write one for Earth, because it was like the celestial bodies, and we all live on Earth, so we didn't. But he wrote one for Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and Neptune. He didn't. That one was also not discovered yet, I think. So the original, I don't know when it was published. Gustav Holst lived from 1874 to 1934. Let's see if it says when Planets. Oh, Planets was 1921. So this is specifically from the Jupiter movement, Jupiter the bringer of jollity. The Jupiter movement of the planets, and in the middle of that movement, there's a chorale, and that's where the melody that we have comes from. If you go and listen to Jupiter, you won't hear this right away. That's why I'm telling you that. So if you go listen to Jupiter, it starts off very different. You got to get several minutes into it before you hear the chorale come in that this melody comes from. The reason it's called Thaxted is because that is the town where Gustav Holst spent much of his life. It's in Essex in England. The meter for this one is 13, 13, 13, 13, 13. Wait. Six phrases of 13 syllables each. It has kind of an ABA form where it's the beginning melody, and then there's a different melody for the middle part, and then it goes back to that beginning melody. There's a rhyming scheme for this one, too. I didn't mention that. All of these hymns have some rhyming schemes. Some of them are weird, though, because some of them, the words, look like they should rhyme, but they don't rhyme in our modern English pronunciations of them. Yeah, and I don't know if I can think of any examples off the top of my head. Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah, so anyway, the rhyming scheme for this one is AABBCC. So it goes with the melodic phrases. They rhyme with each other. And then when you change the phrase, those two rhyme with each other, and then you change the phrase again, and they rhyme again. Time signature is 3/4 with one beat of pickup. So if you're counting 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, da, da, da. There's two notes before the first full measure. Um, Yes, that's connected. Yeah, because when you get to the end of this hymn, okay, this is, I didn't plan to talk about this, but just a quick tangent. When you get to the end of the hymn, they have an incomplete measure so that you can go right back into the beginning without adding any extra time. Now, what a lot of congregations do is when you get to the end, if there's that incomplete measure, sometimes people add like a whole another measure or just some indeterminate length of time before you go back into the beginning one. But this one should feed straight into it. So let me find my iPad. All right, yeah, so when you get to the end of this hymn, you won't hold on to that last word for very long. You'll go straight back to the beginning. Okay. All right, at this point, I'm going to read from the book because I'm going to read from the book. It was originally published with four stanzas. We only have three, you'll notice, in your book. And that's actually really common. Most places that this hymn appears, it's just the three stanzas. Witla, the composer, the hymn writer, he said he was not very keen on this move, which he views as cutting out both the two incarnational and the two feminine images. Here's what he said about the hymn overall. I wrote the hymn in 1989, just after the events of Tiananmen Square, and where the mothers of the disappeared in Argentina were bringing their campaign to the conscience of the world. At the same time, the religious and racial disputes in Ireland, Israel, Palestine, the Congo, and other parts of Africa, and in Canada, and in many other countries over First Nation or Aboriginal rights all seemed impossible to solve. Unfortunately, similar events are still replayed, and only two similar images from the Near East, Iraq, Afghanistan, and now Somalia, not to mention the school shootings at home, recur, and are now extended well beyond those earlier sad happenings. So I used some images from those events, especially in verse 2, which is the one that was cut, seen through echoes of the Holocaust, to tell of the bad news before the good news of verses 3 and 4. Subsequent events only sharpened those images, alas. So, I'm going to read the text of stanza 2 that is the one that has been cut from most places where this is published. Yes. Okay. You're really stretching my comfort level, but we could do that. We could do that. So when we sing through this, we'll all sing verse 1 together. I'll sing verse 2 solo. And then we'll sing verses 3 and 4. So just 4 repeats instead of 3. All right. So here is the text. I'll read it before I sing it. The dreaded disappearance of family and friend. The torture and the silence. The fear that knows no end. The mother with her candle. The child who holds a gun. The old one nursing hatred, all seek release to come. Each candle burns for freedom, each lights a tyrant's fall, each flower placed for martyrs gives tongue to silenced call. So, yeah, profound for sure. I guess I'll sing it. Before we sing it, this same tune, Thaxted, has another hymn in our ELW. It's 880, O God Beyond All Praising. And it's also used for an English song, I Vow to Thee My Country. It's like a patriotic kind of a song that, yes. There's also a composition by Z. Randall Stroop that uses this same chorale. It's called Homeland. I had my high school women's choir sing it a few years ago. It's very good, very moving piece. All right, we ready? Hang on, I'm not ready. Almost. Let me get everything. All right, now I'm ready.
Let
Disappearance of family and friend, the torture and the silence, the fear that knows no end, the mother with her candle, the child who holds a gun, the old one nursing hatred, all seek release to come. Each candle burns for freedom, each lights a tyrant's fall. Each flower placed for martyrs gives tongue to silenced calm. We nail the nations for peace that will not end, for love that makes us lovers, God grant us peace to mend. We've our varied gifts together, knit our lives as they are spun. On your loom of time enroll us, till our thread of life is run. O great weaver of our fabric, bind church and world in one. Dye our textures with your radiance, light our colors with your sun. Your city's built to music, we are the stones you seek. Your harmony is language, we are the words you speak. Our faith we find in service, our hope in others' dreams, our love in hand of neighbor, our home that brightly gleams. Inscribe our hearts with justice, your way the path untried, your truth the heart of stranger, your life a crucified.
Good. Before we conclude, there was one thing I noticed while we were singing through this one. Those syllable numbers, there's a little bit of flexibility with there. For example, in the second, really third, but the second verse printed in your hymnals, there's some extra syllables thrown into those lines, so the hymn writers can be a little creative with how to fit those into the melody. So it doesn't exactly have to be 13, 13, 13, 13, 13. You can throw a couple extra syllables in. Yeah? Uh-huh. Yep, you're right. Sometimes composers also, that's actually the other thing that composers can do, is elide or squish syllables so that they, like, you can take a two-syllable word and make it one syllable by just kind of doing it really quickly. You're right. I know. That's a pet peeve for some. Jennifer? 880? Oh, yes, the other tune for, the other one that uses the faceted tune. If you want. 880? It really does. It changes it entirely. Yeah. I told Matt one time, every time this hymn tune is suggested, I pick it because I just love it. I could listen to it all day long. But you're right. It does feel different with that second verse added in there. Yeah. Oh, neat. Well, that's why. Okay. Let's do all three verses for 880, and then.
Oh God, beyond all praising, we worship you today, and sing amazing that songs cannot repay, for we have been at every gift you sent, and have blessings without
thank you.
I'm going to talk back one of the things I said earlier, which about the ending of verses, and there's sometimes a little bit of a pause. Sometimes that's because Mont has to do organ stop changes. Yeah. Yeah, because she changes the stops that are used for different verses. So also pay attention to that. I wasn't planning on talking about this either, but if you listen during the service, after the offertory, before the offertory response, and also in between the communion hymns, Mont does some magic over there where she'll just like... where she will just go from whatever key we're in and just like... noodle around and make her way to the new key, and suddenly we're singing a new song. The music does not ever stop, it just morphs and changes. So, well, this morning she asked if the handbells was playing Faith of Our Fathers, and she asked if we were playing it in G major. And I was like, yes, and I didn't even think about it for a second. And then I was like, why does she want to know what key we're singing? Is she going to play with us? And I was like, no, because she's going to take the musical material and lead us into the offertory response, which she did. So we're very blessed to have Mott. I wanted to read, it's a very short paragraph, but I wanted to read about the text for 880 since we just sang it, that uses that same tune. So it says, Michael Perry wrote this hymn for the tune Faxted to supply a text for worship rather than the one associated with it, I Vow to Thee My Country. It first appeared in Hymns for Today's Church in 1982 and is an expansive hymn of praise, as one might expect from an expansive tune such as this. It moves from God's mercies generally to what God has done for Christ, done in Christ specifically, to our response in Christ. So, Michael Perry heard that I Vow to Thee My Country, and he's like, that's great, but it'd be great to be a little more worshipful. So he wrote this text to fit it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. 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 All right. Thank y'all for being here, and stay tuned for more of this. Who's next? and then I've started like I love spreadsheets, so I started a spreadsheet. Hymns as they're suggested. I'm putting them in here, and I'll share this with you. But,
good.
If you have any suggestions,
I started a Google Sheet,
so I'll throw them on.
I can put mine in.
Sounds good.
Thank you, bro.
Thank you all. Thank you, Mott.